Paulina Dominiak completed her master in science with honors in chemistry 2000 and biology 2001 at our University of Warsaw. Received her PhD degree in chemistry in 2005, also with honors from the University of Warsaw, and I had the pleasure to be Paulina's supervisor, both at the master and PhD levels. Paulina's thesis was dedicated to weak interactions in organic and protein crystals studied with X-ray crystallography, including experimental charge density analysis. During her studies, she visited twice the NASA Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama, in the USA, to work with Dr. Ewa Ciszak. Paulina did her postdoctoral research under Professor Philip Coppens' supervision at Sunny at Buffalo, USA. She spent there 2 years, 2005-2006, working firstly on time-resolved crystallography and then in the charge density field, developing a data bank of atomic electron densities, later on called the University at Buffalo Data Bank, UBDB. In 2007, she moved back to our university, our chemistry department, when she got an assistant professorship position. Here she was further developing UBDB and working on applications to X-ray crystallography and structural biology. For that work, she received a habilitation degree in chemical sciences in 2013. In 2017, she's got the permanent associate professor position, and 3 years later, in 2020, she received the title of professor and full professorship position at our university. Paulina leads the electron density modeling group at the Biological and Chemical Research Center of our university in Warsaw. Her research is focused on quantum crystallography. Her group is developing new electron density modeling methods to X-ray and electron crystallography, structural chemistry, and molecular biology. Currently, she concentrates on introduction of more accurate electron scattering factors to electron crystallography. She published more than 70 original papers. In 2020, she was elected the chair of the Quantum Crystallography Commission of IUCR. She also is an elected member of the Committee on Crystallography, Polish Academy of Sciences, and one of the editors of ACTA CRYST-A. So today, Paulina will talk on modeling electrostatic potential in electron diffraction studies. Paulina, the screen is yours.
Thank you, Krzysztof, for your kind introduction. After chairing so many lectures during this series, I have now very great pleasure and honor to present my own lecture. So let's start. Let's start from the very beginning. In crystallography, whenever we are talking about diffraction, we think about diffraction of a beam on a crystal. And there are many types of beams we are using. Today, I will focus on electron beam and X-rays to compare. X-rays, they do interact with electron density of a crystal. Electrons interact with electrostatic potential. And it's worth to note that electrostatic potential is generated by both electron density and nuclei. Knowing that, we should be able to retrieve these two properties directly from diffraction data. But this is not easy. It's not easy to quantify directly Fourier maps because we are missing phases. We only can approximate them. At the beginning, we are limited by resolution and we are limited by experimental errors. Also, what we are measuring is a thermal average of densities. It's why we are needing to have some kind of model, pre-computed model, and only selected parameters we are able to fit to experimental data. While building the models, we usually assume in crystallography that we can decompose crystals into atomic contributions, and we are focusing on modeling that atomic contributions. This is justified by the observation that the majority of electron density, for example, is focusing in the core region of atoms. The maximum of that function usually coincide with positions of nuclei. We also assume that it is possible to separate thermal motion or motion of atoms from the static electron density and simply then convolute it back during the modeling. With all these assumptions, we can now focus on atomic contributions only and atomic scattering factors. In case of electrons and X-rays, our job is even easier because it's enough that we model electron density and scattering factors, X-ray scattering factors accurately. And then we, from that, can compute accurate electron scattering factors by applying MOD beta formula. So let's start from the very first model, which was introduced at the very beginning of diffraction experiments on crystals, independent atom model. Here we assume that atoms are spherical and do not interact. So it means that we can compute accurately electron density, for example, for each chemical element, and fixed it. And during the refinement, we only refine position of that density and displacement from positions. In fact, we are really using very often quite sophisticated quantum chemical methods to compute atomic scattering factors within this model. We are applying these methods to isolated atoms in the ground state, and then we are averaging densities spherically. Usually we keep this results in a series of tables, or the tables are approximated by the sum of Gaussians. This helps us to use it within the different softwares. The same is done with electron scattering factors. In fact, we are using often the same, exactly the same calculations, the same results done for X-rays, and apply MOD beta formula and have a series of tables with results. And again, that results, this time for electron scattering, we approximate with sum of Gaussian functions. With this kind of design, we fit that model into experiment data by refining positions and ADPs. And in the result, we are obtaining atomic structure, in fact, the model of atomic structure of our crystal. Nowadays, in crystallography, it is very well visible that EM can be the EM has his own shortcomings, although very successful. And even if the model fits to the data quite well, we still see some features which are not random on residual density maps, mostly positive residuals on bondings, which are not described by independent atom model. And how it is in a case of electron diffraction. Here I'm presenting you results, our own results collected on our microscope and independent atom model refinement in kinematical approach on this data. Again, we are seeing some kind of residuals, maybe not a very clear message, all this time are negative, somewhere in the vicinity of bonding. But this time the fitting statistics are not very satisfactory. So now the question is it because of our modeling and insufficiencies of independent atom model are much better visible in electron diffraction, or because we are missing some other effects? In fact, the truth is somewhere in between. Today, I will focus on further improving scattering models, and our two next speakers will talk about some other effects which are also very important to model experimental data properly. But anyway, what we claim is that in X-rays for sure, but also in electron diffraction, it's really the highest time to switch to more realistic model scattering. Talking about electron diffraction, let's focus first on electrostatic potential. So let's move back to the real space. Electrostatic potential computed from various models of electron density. Independent atom model gives us this kind of electrostatic potential for organic molecules. For diffraction studies, this is okay. It does describe the shape of a molecule. We do have maxima at atomic positions. So model seems to be sufficient. But when we compare it with quantum chemical results, we see that we at least are missing very important from chemical point of view features, like negative regions of electrostatic potential associated with electronegative atoms, here oxygen. So the first idea could be, let's improve our model, let's combine it with point charges. In fact, such a model was already proposed in X-ray crystallography, and it's called Kappa model. And within that model, we are able to adjust the number of valence electrons, and we have additional parameter which follows the changing number of electrons. It's expansion contraction parameters. But the question is from where to take values of these parameters. So let's try resp charges. Resp charges, these are point charges very often used in model car mechanics in force fields. And it's how electrostatic potential looks like for this particular molecule when we use resp charges. Okay, it seems that we are solving the problem. We do have now negative regions, and they do resemble the one which we see from quantum chemical calculations. But these are, in fact, at very low level of, maybe not very low, but at low level of contouring. We still do have maxima at atomic positions, but what's the real difference? Let's subtract both from them, each other. And we see that we still are missing information, mainly within the volume of a molecule. This was this very strange Kappa model. Let's go back to the independent atom model. And this is how the deformation, let's call it deformation potential density, looks like. We do have aspherical features, mostly at bonding regions, and they are negative. So somehow our residual potentials we saw from experimental data refinement goes in line with this missing feature not present in dependent atom model. To describe them, we need to introduce a aspherical part into our modeling. And this is a multiple model called, also introduced for X-ray diffraction studies years ago. And within that model, we are now able to take into account charge transfer, radial deformation, expansion, contraction, and angular deformation, aspherical. And again, from where to take this values of these parameters. Studies have shown that values of these parameters are very similar to for atoms which are having similar chemical topologies, environment, chemical environment. So the idea came that we can build a data bank which collects sets of these values specific for different kind of atom types. And we now have in crystallography three such data banks. Today I will focus on UBDB and MATS data bank, because these are data banks which we are developing. MATS data bank, the idea is of any data bank actually is like Lego blocks. So we are having atomic fragments with known density parameters, and from this we are able to reconstruct electron density and electrostatic potential then for any molecule. And it's worth to note that the data banks are created for to describe atom types in organic molecules. How our data bank is created, we are taking coordinates of molecules from crystal structures deposited in the CSD. And we for the single molecules, we are computing DFT wavefunk. We are doing DFT calculations. We are taking DFT or wave functions or electron densities, and we are fitting a multiple model to that functions. As a result, we are having a collection of molecules, model molecules within multiple model, and thousands of atoms, or tens of thousands of atoms, and we are group them into clusters with by a similarity within their density parameters. We are averaging the values of density parameters within the group, and it's how the atom types are appearing in the data. The major problem with the data bank approach is that you may always have an atom in your molecule for which there is no atom type in the data bank. So we checked recently how it is with our data bank. We analyze Cambridge structural database. We extract from it all crystal structures composed from these chemical elements. Good quality, and we analyze them within our approach. And it appears that 98% of atoms are already having atom types in our data bank. And of course, we are working hard to have even larger coverage, and anytime a user is asking for a new atom type, we are able to add it quite fast. And it's how electrostatic potential looks like from a model. We call it transferable aspherical atom model, in which density parameters are transferred from a data bank, from UBDB here. The potential is now quite good, both outside of the molecule and within the molecule. So it should work also much better within the diffraction data analysis. So the idea is that we can now construct TAM model and use it instead of independent atom model in atomic structure refinement everywhere where previously we were using independent atom modeling. In case of X-rays, this was done several times by many groups, and it was proved that within this approach, we are achieving a better fit to the data, to the experimental data, and atomic structure has improved quality. And here, once again, the same results I've showed you before, and results after TM refinement. So indeed, even for the selected examples, you can see that the fitting statistics improves and residual maps are much clearer. And the same, and so that was about the fitting, but how about the atomic structure model? In case of X-rays, the most spectacular effect is improving accuracy of atomic of hydrogen atoms localization and position of hydrogen atoms are of quality close to the quality of models achieved from neutron diffraction studies. How it is in the case of electron diffraction? it's what we are focusing now in our research. And here you have again the same data I've showed you before, independent atom modeling, and after TEM refinement. Again, we see the same effect, lowering of fitting statistics, meaning our model fits better to the data, and clearing a bit residual densities. But still, we see huge huge values of R factors and other fitting statistics, meaning that this is not the only effect we are having in our data and not modeling it yet properly. Let's go further and try to understand whether we can improve TEM modeling. But firstly, to understand whether how TEM already performs well with electron diffraction study, we did some kind of theoretical simulations. We wanted to have diffraction data which are free from any other effects we have in experimental data. So we computed simulated data using periodic DFT calculations for one selected crystal. And we perform more detailed analysis of how TEM refinement works with electron diffraction data. But before I show you results from the refinements, I'm showing you how for this particular molecule, electrostatic potential and electron density looks like. Because already from these pictures, we can predict some results. First of all, let's look at electron density and electrostatic potential. The overall shape of the molecule is in both situations well described. But in case of electrostatic potential, maxima on hydrogen atoms are much better visible than in case of X-rays. So this should result in observation that hydrogens should be much easier, the positions of hydrogens should be much better described during the refinement against this data. Another difference is that this is all the time a positive function. Electrostatic potential has a region where it is a negative value. So it makes our life more difficult. And the third thing is that how the deficiencies of independent atom model looks like. So in both cases, we do have a spherical deformation densities in the bonding region, but here these are positive values, more contracted, and here are negative values, more diffused. So this may suggest that that we'll have different problems with depending on the resolution, and it may influence our thermal motion modeling in different way, in different directions. And results. So we did a refinement with independent atom model or with TEM model on the simulated data, cut it to four different resolutions. And here you have RMSD error for bond lengths to hydrogen atoms. In case of independent atom model, of course, we see what already was many times proved. We are getting too short bond lengths. And with TEM, the bond lengths improved very much. In case of electrons, indeed, already with independent atom model, the error of positioning hydrogen is much smaller and the distances are much better. But always, almost every time too long, and TEM improves this parameter a bit. In case of a thermal motion description or ADPCs in general, we do see effects which are resolution dependent. With high resolution, there is no problem with thermal motion description. But at lower resolution, atomic resolution, independent atom model gives two large AD pieces for X-rays and two small for electrons. And in case of electrons, this is a really a big problem because at some moment they tend to be negative and it is a disaster for stability of the refinement. In case of TM, it improves a lot. We are almost reaching the target values, but something is happening here at low resolution data in case of electron diffraction. And finally, the final statistics, fitting statistics, R factors. In both cases, electron and X-ray, switching from independent atom model to TM model, we are seeing improvements. This is about 1 to 2 percentage point. So we do see improvements here, but still we are not reaching such low level of R factors as in case of X-rays. So within this simulation, we've shown that also with electron diffraction data, we should see improvements in many aspects when we switch from independent atom model to TEM. But we also have some room for improvements. Maybe because electron diffraction data are more sensitive to tiny differences in our modeling than X-rays. Let's investigate it further. Here we have atomic scattering factors for oxygen atom, for electrons on the left and for X-rays on the right, for a neutral atom and for atom of -1 electron charge. In case of X-rays, there is a difference, but let's say a very tiny difference, visible only at very low resolution range below or at below 2.5 angstrom. In case of electrons, the difference is also residing within the same resolution range, but the difference between neutral and charged atom is huge, especially when we move towards lower and lower resolutions. Okay, but in real organic molecules, we don't have atoms which are fully charged. They have only a partial charge. So here it's the same atom, but this time with only a quarter of electron on it. In case of X-rays, this is really almost not visible difference. But in case of electrons, the difference is still huge, only shifted to lower resolution. Yes, so looking at the atomic scattering factors, we can conclude that yes, electrons should be very much more sensitive to any changes in charge or any other deformations. But in fact, in crystals, we have both cations and anions. Do they compensate each other? Here you have this time structure factors, amplitudes, computed for entire crystal, for organic crystal 1-methyluracil. So these are theoretical calculations for the same crystal structure from periodic DFT, electron diffraction on the left and X-ray diffraction on the right. Well, looking at, they are different, but it's really very hard to judge, to say what this difference is telling to us. So maybe we should focus on how different models fit or better differ from the target theoretical simulated data. And here, to independent atom model and TM model from the data bank, we are adding also yet another TM model, this time a model, multiple model fitted to periodic data, so it should include also intermolecular interaction description. And here you have results, difference between target simulated data and given model for electrons and for X-rays. Again, at the first look, it's really hard to say. The only one which we can, the only thing which can say is that in both cases, independent atom model is the worst one. Is there any difference between the two flavors of TM modeling? In case of X-rays, we do see some differences, but they are not systematic, and it's hard to judge which one fits better to the target values. In case of electron diffraction data, up to, let's say, 2.5 resolution, again, those two models seems to be the same, well-fitted. And only at very low resolution region, we are starting to see differences between different flavors of TM. And when you look very closely, you can see that for a couple of reflections, like for this one, periodic TM seems to be the best one. Here again, we have two reflections. Periodic is a little bit closer to zero difference than the others one. Let's see. So here again, in this absolute difference, it's really hard to say, but we should actually look into the relative difference. So we should divide it by the structure factor amplitudes of our target model. And then the message is a bit clearer. In case of X-rays, for these four reflections, there is no, it's really very hard to judge which TAM model fits better. We can say they are both equally good. Independent atom model fits a bit worse to the to this target values. In case of electrons, electron diffraction, for some particular reflections, the fit of periodic TAM is much better than any other model. So the conclusion is there are reflections which are very sensitive to tiny differences in modeling. But how this will work with experimental data? Is it general to every organic crystal? This we don't know, and we really are about to check. These are like general statistics, but let's maybe move further. So how actually we should check it? Maybe we should not fit different kind of models. Maybe we should directly refine electronic parameters against our experimental data. And in such a way, we'll get both atomic and electronic structure from experimental data, and we can then compute properties, which is the most interesting. In case of X-ray crystallography, this was of course done many times with multiple model modeling, and many other models introduced for X-ray diffraction. But for that, we need subatomic data of high quality. In case of electron diffraction data, there are only some pioneering works published so far, and examples you have given here. Mostly either showing only difference maps. Some of them do multiple modeling into X-ray structure factors recomputed from experimental electron structure factors. And here you have one example from CBET technique, slightly different technique than I was mostly focusing on. But still electron diffraction data. What I can say, the future is bright. Many things have to be checked. We have plenty of different models already designed for X-rays in quantum crystallography. and now waiting to be applied, checked, evaluated against electron diffraction data. And with that, I would like to finish and say thanks to all my co-workers and collaborators. Thank you.
Thank you, Paulina, for this brilliant lecture, and which is now open for questions and comments. I can see some. One moment. Is radiation damage a serious problem for 3DED?
Yes, so this is something we really have to check, because we do see that there are many effects we are not taking into account, and it's why our fitting statistics are still worse. Is it radiation damage? For sure there is something in that, because we really have to be careful when we measure our data, because we can overexpose organic crystals, and then during the measurement they die. So we so this must be carefully taken into account during data measurements. But is it possible to measure data without radiation damage? Probably yes, but we don't have systematic proof for that yet.
So that was question from Andrzej Olczak. Now question from Pierre Becker. Is it possible to use combined studies to understand crystal deformation close to surfaces?
Yes, but for that you would need to have really much more sophisticated modeling, because at the moment with all this what I've shown you, we assume that you have infinite crystal, and we would need to develop much better different models to take into account.
Okay, and now a question from Professor Bogdan Lessing regarding the observation that electrons are more sensitive to electron density deformations than X-rays. Can we really treat the electron density as an independent object from the incoming in the experiment electrons? The incoming electrons become an internal element of the electron density, modifying it?
This is a very good question. I have not mentioned about the experimental condition for 3D electron diffraction experiment we are now mostly focusing. So the experiment is designed in such a way that we are using very energetic electron beams, which so these electrons carries much higher energy than electrons in our crystal we are measuring. So that so we assume that there is no interaction. Otherwise, we would need to have much more sophisticated modeling of the scattering.
Okay. I do not see more question at the moment, but let me ask my question. How about a weak description of weak interactions using UVDB and similar data banks? Can you explain, is it effective description? Is it possible? Is it good? It could be improved. What's your opinion about this?
So first of all, the data banks I was talking about, they are constructed, well, two of them, on the basis of single molecule. So what they model is electron density of a single molecule. So we do not have direct information about any deformation of density caused by intermolecular interactions. But still, when you would like to analyze intermolecular interactions, anyway, the biggest contribution to that is the electron density of unperturbed yet by the neighbors. Then the polarization and changes due to interactions are like a second order kind of contribution to the our interactions. So you can still use the data banks to describe in the first approach thermonuclear interactions.
Mm-hmm. My second question, you were showing a nice difference when you are comparing like two models, distribution of different reflections or differences between modules of structure factors. Are there any particular groupings or any particular relations in subgroups of these reflections? You are showing some or very few reflections, but how about reflections with the same parity? How about reflections in particular parts of reciprocal lattice? Are there any regularities in all this?
For sure, there are two groups of reflections, one which are almost non-sensitive to the modeling, probably dominated by the core electrons, which do not change a lot. And the other is very sensitive to the models. It's too early to say. We haven't focused on that yet.
Okay. There is Hans-Bert is asking, if I understand your results correctly, all your results are based on kinematical calculations and kinematical modeling. To what extent will your conclusions hold once you turn to the experimental data, which require dynamical modeling?
Yeah, that is a very good question. It's what we are at the moment are investigating together with Łukasz. And I think that Łukasz will tell a bit about it more. At the moment, we want to experimentally find out whether the more accurate scattering factors designed in this way also improve fit while used in dynamical within the dynamical refinement model. Another question is if this kind of approach really is valid. This we have not focused on. But we do have some first results showing how better scattering models works with dynamical refinement. And you will see in the last lecture.
Okay. Thank you very much for these answers. I can see some other people typing in the questions now, so let us wait for a second. I'm sure that after those next two lectures will be far more will far more understand the nature of this dynamical Ashwin Suresh, how much does the order of PLM values depend on the refinement? Because ELMAM database is still third order, whereas MATS has order of four.
Mm-hmm. So the reason why ELMAM has only order of three and MATS has four is because ELMAM is based on experimental data. And with experimental data, you do not always have enough information, or you have some experimental errors to be able to do refinement up to order of four. So that is the safest approach to be sure that we are really extracting information on the noise. With MATS, we are using vertical densities, so we actually can go even further. But in case of organic molecules, it's not always needed. So we are always checking whether values of PLMs at four order are still statistically significant. So in case of simulated data, they are. In case of experimental, not always. So that's the main reason why these two data banks have different order. Mm-hmm. Whether you see it then in at the application stage, we have not checked it very carefully, but the order of four, I mean the hexadecouples in organic molecules usually have very small values, so these are like tiny corrections to what to the lower order.
Okay, thank you very much. I do not see anybody writing any comments or questions. So thank you very much, Paulina, for this excellent lecture and discussion.